subscribe button to subscribe to our channel. Press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
This is Chaitanya. I am going to deal daily editorial analysis from today. This is a program especially designed to make students easier to understand the editorial and how we can use the editorial effectively in writing answers in the examination. As the UPSC civil service examination is excessively relying on the current affairs topic to judge the knowledge of the individual student and also his capability to analyze this issue in diverse viewpoints, it is necessary for us to concentrate on the daily editorial analysis. Though there are various views that the editorial analysis is time consuming, but because of the kind of marks or the kind of questions that are being asked in the examination, it is necessary to understand each and every topic in detail, and you will have command only if you understand the daily editorial analysis, because the editorial gives you diverse viewpoints that are necessary to add value to your answers, and thus you can be ahead of various competitors. This is a competitive exam, thus why you need to upgrade these kinds of knowledge to you. Okay, I'm going to explain you two questions from GS2 and GS3, in which I will explain you how editorial analysis helped to write these kinds of answers. Okay, and also bring viewpoints as well as points that are necessary to improve the value of the answer. And then I will explain you why you have to follow this daily editorial analysis of the Hindu in the Kautilya Careers YouTube channel. Firstly, the GS2 question of the 2018, the first question is, in the light of recent controversy regarding the use of electronic voting machines, okay, what are the challenges before Election Commission of India to ensure trustworthiness of the election? Because the trust on the Election Commission of India is receding in the country, and not only that, the allegations that there are tampering of electronic voting machines is heavily put forward by the opposition parties of the country. Okay, to what extent their allegations are true or not, we are not bothered, but what we are bothered is whether the Election Commission of India is independent or not, whether there is a real chance of tampering the electronic voting machines. Okay, we need to have points of these questions and why certain allegations are raised in the first place. Firstly, the controversies are the allegations of EVM tampering, that in a by-election that has happened in Maharashtra, one independent candidate has polled votes wherein his family's votes were also not shown in the vote count. That means there is something happening in the tallying of votes, because why did not the voting count of that particular family showed an increase. That means there are transferring of votes that are clearly perceivable. Okay, that, and the allegations are that various votes polled by various individuals have been diverted to the ruling party, and that's why it came to power, or that's why the candidate who was contesting on behalf of that party was elected from that constituency. This happened in the by-election in Maharashtra. Okay, but this controversy was subsided. We need to review whether it is a reality or not. Next, coming to the other point, is many electronic voting machines in the UP malfunctioned, that is in the Uttar Pradesh by-elections that has happened recently. Many of the electronic voting machines that are present in particular constituencies wherein the minority population, that is Muslim and Dalit population, are higher, there the electronic voting machines that have malfunctions have been reported. But the reason cited by Election Commission of India is not agreeable. That is, it is not believable. It said that due to the heat prevalent at that point of time, these voting machines got malfunctioned. Okay, can anyone believe these viewpoints? Okay, that's why the trust on these electronic voting machines is receding, because the concentration of this electronic voting malfunctioning is in particular community constituencies. Okay, and the other allegation is that counting of votes. Okay, in the Uttar Pradesh, after the by-election is completed, during counting of votes, every media person is to be allowed entry into the counting halls. But what happened is, the district magistrate of that constituency did not allow media to enter into these counting halls, and thus the accountability will be in question. Okay. Despite these allegations and the reality too, that is, it is a reality that the district magistrate did not allow the individual or the media houses to enter into the counting halls, he is not suspended. Actually, he has been promoted. So, what kind of model the ruling government is setting in these kinds of elections? And what is the role that is being played by Election Commission of India in all these controversies as well? And difficulty to review the votes using VVPAT, that is, voter verifier paper audit trial, gives whether the vote polled by an individual to a candidate has occurred in the first place or not, because he is going to get a certificate which shows whether his vote went to a party to which he has voted in the first place or not. What the necessitates this use of VVPAT is because of the increased controversies of vote diversion. But the problem is to review whether the VVPATs that are generated during the elections can be counted and tallied upon the result of the election. The problem is the cumbersome procedure to get the approval. Firstly, an individual has to go to High Court and file a petition that there are certain maladies in the final result of the election. And after he goes to the High Court, and if the High Court gives the approval, and then he can start verification with respect to VVPATs, that is, whether the VVPATs generated in the elections are matching with the real voting counts that have been done by these counting halls. Okay, thus, if they are matched, then they can surely come to a conclusion that there was no tampering of EVMs. Okay, so in this way, review process has to be developed such that the trust on the Election Commission of India as well as electronic voting machines can be upheld. So these are the controversies that led to the kind of low trust upon the Election Commission of India. The way ahead is, first, the independence of Election Commission of India is to be restored, because as of now, the overwhelming role of the executive to appoint the Chief Election Commission as well as election commissions is reducing the chance of holding them to account. That is, you have to give the chance or the procedure to appoint in such a manner that executive's role will be minimized, and it has to have multiple stakeholders in appointing the Election Commission of India officials. For example, in various appointments, we are seeing the role of judiciary, the role of executive, the role of legislatures as well. For example, from the legislature, we will bring leader of opposition, from executive, prime minister, from judiciary, chief justice of India. If all of these are involved, then there can be some sort of independence that can be brought in appointing the Election Commission of India official, and thus he will be neutral rather than pro to a particular government. So, to uphold the independence of Election Commission of India, we have to bring a reformation in the procedure of appointing Election Commission of India officials, and also the status given as well as the independence given to the Chief Election Commission of India is not extended to the other two election commissions. So, what we have to do to restore the independence of the entire Election Commission of India, we have to extend the powers that have been vested in the hands of Chief Election Commission to other election commissions as well. So, if the power is vested in three election commissions in the Election Commission of India, then we can certainly believe or certainly uphold that there is an independence in functionality of Election Commission of India as well. And next, the VVPAT, the verification should be made easier, because today if you want to verify whether the votes polled are polled to a particular candidate as per the choosing of the voter or whether they have been diverted to a particular party, there has to be made easier verification, because we have seen various controversies that has arisen in various parts, especially in the by-elections of Maharashtra and by-elections in the Uttar Pradesh. So, verifying should be made easier, it should not be made cumbersome. So, they have to be made automatic, so that when the counting of votes completes, the subsequent verification through VVPAT should also be done. And then, seeking alternatives if possible. That is, presently, as electronic voting machines are liable for tampering And many of the advanced countries like United States and Germany, etc., have moved on to ballot papers rather than relying on these electronic machines because they are susceptible for tampering. As Indian technology is not well developed and we are actually depending upon other countries to supply our electronic voting machines, and the technology is also imported. So what we have to do, we have to seek alternatives and we have to move on to ballot paper if possible, because if not today, tomorrow the ruling party might misuse them, then ultimately our democracy will see a downfall. Elections are key to continue our democracy. Okay, all these points I have gathered from the newspaper. From editorial analysis, you can understand these viewpoints and also the allegations and analyze the topics in detail. Here, the Election Commission of India, we learn from the static topic, but whether we have to extend the appointment independence or not, we have to analyze it. Okay, all these points can be well understood when we seek daily editorial analysis. And then the previous GS3 question from the 2018. The question is, affordable, reliable, sustainable, modern energy is sine qua non to achieve sustainable development goals. Firstly, you have to know about the sustainable development goals, as well as the second part of the question is, comment the progress made by India in this regard. That is the current affairs topics. Whether we really have transformed the way in which we are producing as well as utilizing the energy or not. Okay. Firstly, we have to know about the sustainable development goals. This in brief are for pursuing healthy life, because the usage of conventional fuels like petrol, diesel is leading to high emissions of gases and polluting the environment, and also the greenhouse gases released are increasing the temperatures. So what we have to do? We have to see that this temperature can be controlled by reducing the emissions, as well as see that the pollutants released are to be minimized. And thus, what we have to do? We have to change the way we are consuming the energy. We have to depend upon solar power, wind power, etc. And also, in running any vehicles, instead of using combustion mechanism, what you have to do? We have to see that it is run through electronic power. This completely minimizes or completely eliminates the emission of pollutants in the environment, and protecting the planet, as I already explained to you, because of increased temperature, the climate change is happening quicker, and the number of organisms dying on the cause is higher, and also human beings are dying because of the excessive pollutants released in the environment. So we have to reduce them. And the dignity of the people and poor especially, because these kinds of developments that we are pursuing as of now are exclusive in nature. That is, growth is being concentrated in only few individuals, and the price paid by these poor people in these achievements of development is higher, because especially the low-lying areas will be submerged during the time of higher rainfalls. Especially the poor people who are residing in the coastal areas will be affected by increasing sea level. So we have to see that they do not get affected. And then inclusive and prosperous growth, we have to see that the growth that we are achieving today will also bring fruits to the lower income levels as well, because it is getting concentrated in the upper echelons of our economy. And the justice, that is, every individual should get justice from the kind of problems he is facing due to this changing environment. That is, we have to provide additional facilities to the individual so that they can also adapt to the changing environment. And the present status is heavy reliance on thermal energy. We are relying upon the coal power for close to 60% of our energy requirement. And this reliance will lead to high emissions of carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide gases, which are both polluting in nature and also have global warming potentials as well. And the diesel and petrol power for traveling, because the diesel power and petrol power is still used for traveling purpose. We are generating a lot of gases. These are polluting as well as increasing our temperatures. Then high industrial emissions, because we are not curbing the industrial emissions. We are not putting some kind of catalytic converter so that we can reduce the emissions. So we have to also curb them. And thus the regulations should be binding and see that the industries are compliant upon these guidelines as well. And the production of solar power and wind power is being encouraged by Government of India, and that is a commendable initiative. So we are trying to transform ourselves, and also we have a mission to increase our reliance upon the electrical mobility, so that is to rely upon the electrical energy for transportation, and need to build storage infrastructure, because as of now we do not have proper storage infrastructure that is necessary to increase the transmission of green energy, that is the energy generated by solar power, wind power, etc. The problem is they generate periodically. For example, solar power is generated during the daytime, and during the night time there is no generation. So we need to have proper storage facilities and also grid facilities so that we can transmit the power. So all these are to be done, and government is trying to do. Okay, so we are still at a status of achieving them. And BS4 emissions, we have set BS4 emissions target to the automobiles so that the emissions received emitted by them can be reduced, and also see that we are trying to achieve BS6 by 2022, and that will further increase the regulations upon the automobile manufacturers and thus improve the environment. This is necessary for sustaining the growth, reducing the power of energy consumption, because diesel and energy power are higher, diesel and petrol are becoming more costlier, thus they become affordable, they become reliable because they are renewable in nature, that is we can rely upon them in the future generation. They are sustainable because they do not cause harm to the future generation, and also as they are cheaper in nature, they can be utilized by lower income individuals, and thus they are inclusive in nature. And they are modern energy because they have emerged as of now, and we are generating more and more technological capabilities to reduce the prices of generation as well. So these are about our analysis. And next, coming to why you need to refer this daily editorial analysis in the first place. The analysis topic, firstly understanding the various dimensions of any issue. Okay, each editorial brings his own perspective. He might be critical of the government, or he might be more free and pro to government measures. We have to understand both of them and try to assess an objective view of that topic rather than being swayed by our personal opinions. We have to write an answer which is critical of any issue prevalent in the country. We have to see both sides, and that is necessary. That can be brought only by understanding both viewpoints that are put forward in the newspaper, and reducing the time constraint, because it takes a lot of time to read this editorial. So what we can do easily is by dividing it into various parts and understanding the essence that is put forward by the editor, we can simply concentrate on them and reduce our time and understand these complex topics as well. Simplification because of complexity by various editors, okay, and their deep knowledge, they simply write the present essence of that issue. And thus we have to also understand the background of it. If you understand the background, then you will be able to understand the present and also its comprehensiveness, and thus it will be simplified by showing you in detail. And note making, I will see that the entire paragraph is written in just 2 to 3 words. Thus you can easily make the notes rather than making it cumbersome, and you can also revise it thoroughly in the future when the examination is coming. And next, the diverse viewpoints. As I explained you, editor has his own viewpoints, and on the basis of his personal interests, he writes the editor. You have to understand all forms, and these are given in Hindu in detail. Though it is time consuming in certain cases, we have to rely upon these editors, editorial, because the examination has moved mostly to current affairs orientation rather than depending upon the static affairs. Though you need to understand the static subjects, but you can apply the static subjects only if you know the current affairs only. Okay, and application can be improved through the usage of current affairs, and thus you will master both the static as well as current affairs. And that's why you have to follow this section. This section is free as of now, and this is presented to you by Kautilya Careers YouTube channel. For any updates, please subscribe to our channel Kautilya Careers. Thank you. Yeah. Today I'm going to deal about the daily editorial analysis of the Hindu of the date 1st November 2018. Okay. For any further updates, please subscribe to our channel Kautilya Careers. Firstly, the important topics of which are relevant to the exam, which I have found it in the newspaper today, are as follows. Need for migration policy. Okay, earlier itself we have seen an instance in the Gujarat wherein mass migration of these immigrants from various northern states who are Hindi speaking have occurred. Okay, So what has happened is one of the reasons for this mass migration, that is mass exodus of these migrants from this Gujarat state, is due to the prevalence of discrimination among the local populace against the Hindi speaking northerners. Okay, the reason behind it is because the job opportunities are lower, and the people inhabiting the Gujarat, that is the original inhabitants of Gujarat, felt that the job opportunities have been taken away by the immigrants who came from the northern side. And not only that, the kind of violence perpetrated by few individuals have been taken as an instance, and thus the anger that was festering in the original inhabitants of the Gujarat has been unleashed. Okay, so what we have to do is we have to build a new policy that takes care of immigrations, because in our country there is inter-regional inequality. The chances of migration are quite high. Okay, we should develop a policy wherein the individuals of various states accept these immigrants from other states. We have to promote unity, and not only that, the immigrants of immigrants in various states who are coming for the sake of livelihood opportunities should also be taken care of by providing various opportunities, and also we should provide them civic amenities. We should see that they are not paid at lower level. We should see that they are provided security in employment. We should see that they do not incur heavier expenses because they did not find livelihood opportunities. So that is why we need to frame a policy, because these immigrants are forming an important source of income for their villagers. That is, they are leaving out the rural areas because of the distress prevalent in there and migrating to other states so that they can provide the income source to their families who are in the villages. So that is what has been given in this article. We are going to see the reasons for this migration, both push factors and pull factors, and also other reasons as well. Okay, that is about the need for migration policy. Next, coming to the strategic autonomy, that is, why should India be given, or why should India exercise its strategic autonomy rather than aligning its policies in consonance with other countries' policies? For example, we are a democratic country. We see United States in high esteem, and we also try to become a superpower in the future, equivalent to the power status that is exercised as of now by the United States. So what we have to do, we have to try to align our views or align our interest in certain context with the US, and other interests we have to pursue so that we can pursue our own national interests rather than compromising them. Okay, that we are going to see in this article. Why is there a necessity to observe strategic autonomy, that is, take independent decisions that are tangible with the interests of our country? Okay, we are also going to see the kind of US policies that are contradictory in nature. That is, it is taking different stances in various cases. It is taking U-turns, and following those policies will ultimately impact our interests in the national level. Okay, and the last is public armed constabulary and their conviction. An incident has occurred wherein various individuals who are public armed constabulary have coordinated an attack on Muslim community. Okay, firstly, there was a communal riot, and in one of the instant, an individual, that is an officer who belonged to the public armed constabulary, brother has been killed in that incident. So what they have done is to avenge them, that is to take revenge, they simply massacred lot of Muslims. So this trial was happening for ages. It took almost 3 decades to complete the trial. Okay, we are going to see what is a necessity so that people can hold their trust in this criminal justice system, and why is there a necessity that this criminal justice system should be fair, should be not impacted by prejudices and all these matters, and why it is delaying the procedure. We have to see that the conviction happen quickly, and these convictions should be fair and objective in nature as well. So these are the topics that I am going to discuss today, and the rest have been given, which are topics belonging to the political affairs. We do not need to involve in this political analysis of different parties, as well as the country like Brazil's politics are not necessary to us. Okay, we need we need to understand the relations between Brazil and India, but not the internal politics of Brazil. That's why I left these topics. Okay. Firstly, coming to the need for migratory policy, that is migration. Migration means an individual who moves from one place to other. Okay. In here, he is moving mostly for livelihood opportunities. Here, I'm going to explain you the pull and push factors. Firstly, pull factors, that is the attractiveness of the urban areas or other states, which is pulling or which is attracting these migrants to migrate in the first place. These are better livelihood opportunities. As you know, urban areas or urban cities are the economic growth drivers of a country. That is, the economic activity that is happening in the urban areas is very high and the growth rate is also very high. So it provides more opportunities for livelihood. So many of the individuals try to go to these urban areas to avail these opportunities. Thus, it is attracting the migrants as a source of livelihood because they are not able to earn much by living in their villages or in their original place. And next, the good education facilities and also health facilities, because as you know, the health facilities in the rural areas as well as in the mandal areas is very low. Thus, urban areas attract them. And not only that, these health facilities are not uniformly distributed throughout the country. In certain developed states in the country like Gujarat or Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra, the health facilities are of top-notch quality and also education facilities are also of top-notch quality. So to have the access to them, they try to migrate. Okay, the push factors, nothing but because presently we are witnessing rural distress because still the economy in the rural areas is dependent upon agriculture. We are witnessing the productivity levels that are stagnant in the village areas, that is in our agricultural farms, the productivity is stagnant and we are seeing fragmentation of land, that is reduction of size of land holding, and thus they are becoming uneconomical. And not only that, the weather adversities leading to floods, droughts, etc., these are all impacting the economy of the rural areas. As the rural areas cannot continue to rely upon the farm economy, they have to see that they get employment opportunities from other sources as well. And there is also mechanization of agriculture. This reduces the reliance upon the wage labor by the agricultural farms. Okay, so they depend upon machines rather than relying upon the wage labor. So all these provides a necessity to find alternatives for livelihood opportunities. And also, as I said, there are lack of opportunities, that is other opportunities are lacking in the village areas, and also there is poor facilities with respect to education, health, etc. So to improve their lifestyle, they move to other areas. That is why migration happened in the first place in the country. The issues with the migration are, though the migrants try to find better opportunities in the other areas, the issues that they face while migrating are as follows. Firstly, informal employment. They are unable to get formal employment in other areas. That is, formal employment provides them employment security in the first place. Not only employment security, they will get various social protection measures. For example, they will have insurance facilities, they will have pension facilities, etc. Whereas the informal employment are low paying in nature. That is, the wages provided to the immigrants who rely upon informal economy are lower in nature because they are labor intensive and cash intensive, and the regulation of these economy by the government is lower and poor in nature because the informal economy is cash intensive and also the investment is lower, and many cases they employ lesser than 10 people and the working conditions are pitiable. Okay, thus these migrants are facing a lot of problems in pursuing the opportunities in the migrated areas. Okay, and in many cases it has been found that the wages paid to these migrants is very low compared to the local populace. For example, a survey has told that it is only paying 2/3 of the wages which were actually paid to other migrants, sorry, the local populace. That is, they are getting away by paying lower wages to them. This is because non-implementation of laws that regulate these migrant labors. That is, there is also a law which regulates how the migrant labors are to be dealt with. They are to be provided with equal wages. They are to be provided with various civic amenities, that is roads or housing, etc., and they are to be provided with social protection measures as well. But this is not being implemented properly by various states because of the lobbying done by various companies. Because companies try to restrict or reduce their investment costs by simply reducing the amount of wages they pay to the laborers. And the time required to get job, they are not going to get the job as soon as they land in the areas they are migrating, because they have to find out the opportunities that are best suitable for them and then try to avail the jobs. And the next is cost bear until then, that is, until they find any livelihood opportunity, they have to bear their own costs. That further decreases their chance of finding jobs as well as the time they suffer in the destination. And proper housing, sanitation facilities are lacking to them because their low income or the amount of money they bring to this place and the amount of money they earn, this will not be suitable to have a healthy living in that migrated place. Thus, their living conditions are pitiable in nature. There are improper sanitation facilities or housing facilities. They get stuck in particular regions and they live in slum areas. What we have to do is we have to provide them proper opportunities for a healthy living too. And the reinforcement of identities, that is, still there is a discrimination upon the identity of individual, whether he belongs to a tribal background or Dalit background or other backgrounds, okay, he is being discriminated. Also, the kind of job opportunities provided to these migrant laborers, which are of lower in quality, that is informal nature, is still reinforcing their identity that they are of lower status compared to the local populace. Because if these individuals are given job opportunities at with respect to jobs that are high paying and have security in nature, then the status would have been higher. But because they are provided with the jobs that are of lower quality in nature and lower paying, they are receiving a beating in terms of the status that they are attached in that migrated destination. This is about the issues that are being faced by the migrated laborers. But there are certain positives too. Okay, the individual with skills and having connections and also experience in terms of job opportunities is able to get good jobs in the urban areas. Okay, thus he is getting high paid jobs and thus he is able to earn more when compared to other jobs. And the temporary migration is the common place as of now, because an individual migrates to a destination when there is an rural distress in the first place. That is, if there is rural distress because of the lack of opportunities to earn more, he tries to migrate and earn there. Okay, thus for a temporary period of time, he tries to earn certain amount of money, and this money he sends back to the rural areas, which we call as remittance. Okay, this acts as a lifeline to the family. Okay, thus in some way migration is helping an individual to cope with the life difficulties as well, and it increases credit worthiness. That is, an individual who is earning in the urban areas has higher chances of availing the access to credit, that is taking loan. This is also important because he can become self-reliant while investing the money from the loan he takes. Okay, the need of the policy, that is why we need to form a policy, is policy intervention because of the various issues that are being faced by the individuals. We have to take care of all the problems faced by them. Okay, for example, tackling diversity. There are diverse sections who migrate. Some are from Dalit background, some are from lower class background, some are from upper class background. We have to have the information of all of this. By having information, we can form certain policies. We can take care of what kind of employment opportunities they are pursuing, and by having this information we can provide them and thus reduce the costs for them to get proper facilities, either in terms of livelihood or in terms of housing, etc. And also we have to address rural distress, because by addressing rural distress, firstly you can prevent the migration from happening in the first place. As of now, urban areas are not able to cope with the migrant populations that are trying to enter into the cities, because the infrastructure levels of the urban areas is not high enough. We need to build more houses, we need to have higher sanitation facilities, we need to have proper waste disposal mechanisms. All these have to be taken care of. Okay, instead of filling the urban areas with more and more population, we have to see that this migration does not happen in the first place. We have to see that the urban amenities that are present in the urban areas are to be provided even in the rural areas too, so that they will stop migrating. Because due to the lack of facilities and opportunities, they are migrating to the urban areas. And the skilling, because an individual with skills will have higher chance of availing job opportunities that are high paying in nature. So we have to provide the skilling facilities. Already we have various skilling schemes promoted by Government of India. Especially National Skill Development Council was established so that within the National Skill Qualification Framework, various skills are provided to the individual so that they can cope with the various requirements put forward by companies for recruitment. And for families migrating, that is, in certain cases, not only the individual, he migrates with the families, they require more higher facilities. For example, they require proper housing, because not only one individual is surviving here, the entire family, we have to provide them proper educational opportunities that requires proper documentation, because most of the individuals or families that are migrating will try to seek opportunities in the government educational institutions and also government hospitals. We have to see that the policy is provided wherein even the migrants from other states are provided these opportunities rather than extending it to only the local population. And in this manner, we can cope with that migration taking place and also take care of their welfare as well. We as a country have to consider the welfare of the entire country rather than trying to pursue the state interest itself. We have to assure the local populace of the state too that their interest also will be taken care of. It is not that only the migrants are treated well, and because the migrants are cheaper in nature in comparison to the local populace, because the enterprises are paying lesser wages, that's why they are getting more attention. We have to see that both are placed in equal status so that they can compete with each other, and thus both are to be provided with equal wages, as well as both are to be given the social protection that is required for sustaining healthy life. This is about the migration pull and push factors and the need for policy intervention. Now coming to the strategic autonomy. Why should a country like India have a strategic autonomy in the first place? Firstly, there are many individuals or experts who say that instead of following our own national interests, we have to align them along with the US. Okay? The main reasons put forward by them to align the interests with the US are as follows. Firstly, access to the technology. Okay? The technological capabilities of United States of America are far superior when compared to any other country in the world. So, to have the access to the technology, we have to see that United States can rely upon us as an ally because our interests are in concurrence with them. Okay? So, generally, US gives the technological access, that is superior technological access, to its allies. For example, North Atlantic Treaty Organization is a military organization which is spearheaded by the United States, wherein all the countries have a common military base and as well as common military operation structure, so that in case of an attack by any other country, okay, in with one of the country which is of which is a member of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, then all shall attack this country so that they can provide the defense to the country who belongs to the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. So this ultimately improves or increases the trust levels between the United States and the countries of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. And for that purpose, US provides various technological access as well. For example, F-35A fighter aircraft, it is the topmost fighter aircraft in the world with all kinds of advanced technology adapted in it. And also the Guardian drones, okay, these are also topmost quality drones with superior technology. So to have the access to them, we need to align our interest with the US. And it says the US is the richest country in the world and its GDP is 18 trillion, close to 18 trillion. So the individuals in the US are very rich and we need their capital so that we can improve our infrastructure, we can improve our investment environment, we can start new enterprises, etc. Thus we can improve our economy as a whole. by relying upon US individuals, because high net worth individuals are higher in nature. And as we can already see, because of the plans put forward by the United States after the World War II, the Western countries like England, Germany, etc., were able to take the opportunities presented by the US plan, that is Marshall Plan, and thus they were able to improve their economic status as well. So in the similar manner, by trying to tap these kinds of opportunities, Indian economy might also develop. And the trade access, because of its higher, because of its superior economic size, it has the capability to buy more goods. That is, it can import more and more goods. So by exporting more goods to the US, because US wants to provide various favorable conditions, as we are trying to align our interests with the US, then ultimately our economic activity will be fostered. That is, the pace of production will increase because we have ready demand from the United States. So in this manner too, we will have a chance to improve. And next, the most powerful military, because we are facing threats from Pakistan, China, etc. By relying upon United States and having an alliance with it, we can easily deter both countries, because in the future there is a threat of dual warfare, because two front war, one from the China side and one from the Pakistan side. We need help from other countries as well, because China is superior in terms of technology as well as armed military force when compared to India. We need assistance from United States. But there are issues with the US policy as well, because US policies are driven by the interest of US, not Indians. Okay, we have our own interests that depend upon our economic, our political conditions. Okay, so certain individuals argue that we should not align our interests with the US. We should decide upon the issues on the basis of merit. Okay, that is, whether they are aligning with our national interests or not. That is, whether they improve our public interest pursuance or not. For example, the U-turns taken by US are entanglement in US wars. That is, in the future, if the US interests are threatened and US will wage a war, then it ultimately leads to dragging of our country into US wars. Okay, so instead of getting embroiled in the matters of US, that is interest of US, we have to pursue our own interests, and we have to form alliance on the basis of merits. And next, it's China policy. At once it says that it is befriending China, that is what given in the article, and once it deals or it confronts with China. Okay, this what happens by pursuing the US policy is that we will also have tense relations with China. China is in our neighborhood, and China is also economically powerful, second only to United States, and we need to try to access trade with the China so that we can also export more, and thus we can take the benefit of both US and China in terms of trading. So instead of relying upon US and having a conflict with China, what we have to do is we have to deal with both of them rather than pursuing policies of US. And next, the Pakistan policy. At once it says that it is going to detach all kinds of money it is granting to Pakistan, and at other points it not only provides arms and ammunition, it also provides aid to the China. That is, it provides grants in billions of dollars. Thus, this money is used by Pakistan to target India. Thus, this raises questions about the kind of motives put forward by US. Okay, whether it is pursuing India's interest or whether it is trying to pursue Pakistan's interest to check India. Okay, and it's dealing with Myanmar. When Myanmar is spearheaded by a military ruler, and still it is being ruled by military indirectly, because the civilian government has lower powers compared to the military regime, it says that we should stop any kind of relations with Myanmar. But in other times, the country itself deals with Myanmar, and it stands on climate change. Barack Obama pushed India to confirm or to sign the Paris conference, and now US itself is trying to get rid of this Paris conference and says that any kind of measures it put forward to implement Paris climate deals, it is going to withdraw from it. Thus, it ultimately impacts the climate goals that are to be achieved by globe as a whole. And next, it's Iranian policy. Once it negotiates a deal with Iran and thus removes the sanctions imposed upon it, Later on, it again reimposed the sanctions on certain other grounds. But we have interest with Iran. We want more oil from the Iran because presently we are depending upon imports of oil resources because 80% are required from the importing as well. We have to diversify these imports, not only relying on Saudi Arabia. We have to import from Iran, we have to import from Russia, etc. Whereas US has conflicting interests with Iran and Russia. So our interests and US differ. If we try to imbibe or adapt our foreign policy by relying heavily upon United States, then these interests will be threatened. Okay, thus we have to have our own voice. This is more prudent. That's why India is also dealing with Russia. It is dealing with Iran, though they are a sort of enemies to United States. This is a good foreign policy, though it might reduce our cooperation levels with the United States. And the next, coming to public armed constabulary and its conviction. As I already told you the background behind it, 16 individuals were convicted because they involved in Hashimpura massacre. That is, many of the Muslim individuals have been killed by them. Okay, they came in public uniform itself, and many of the individuals were put in a van and ultimately put to death. And this happened 31 years ago. This shows the slow pace of prosecution. It is such a delay, 31 years. Okay, and lower court has acquitted them already because of the lack of evidence. Because any kind of evidence that can be used against these individuals who are involved in this grievous crime were being or were simply dismissed or simply made to non-existent. Okay, thus, due to the non-existence of any kind of evidence, they were acquitted by the lower court. But what has happened is Delhi High Court has went in further details, collecting all of them, and thus was able to establish that these individuals were involved in massacring them. And thus, it imposed a punishment, that is life imprisonment, that is prisoning, prison term until their life tenure completes. The way ahead is, you have to see that the criminal justice system is swift. It should not take 31 years to complete prosecutions. And if you take this long, then ultimately the trust upon the criminal justice system will erode. And particularly certain community believe that the country's justice system is not blind. It should be blind, it should be objective, it should treat everyone equally. But what is happening here, when the minorities come into picture, the justice system remains very slow. And thus it should be fair, it should treat everyone equally, and the judiciary and police system too has to be fair. Here police were prejudiced, that is they have certain negative stereotypes upon certain community, that is here the Muslim community, because one of the individual's brother has been attacked in these communal riots. They simply continued their duty with prejudice rather than having a different perspective on how to use the public power. Okay, the public power should be used to pursue public interest. Here the interest is of the nation, not the particular individual and not the particular community, but the different communities as well. So to increase the trust, the justice system should be swift and the prosecution should be objective, and the conviction should be swifter. Why the conviction is slower? Because of the judicial procedures involved. The Indian Evidence Act is to be reformed because there is a provision that the evidence should be beyond reasonable doubt. In certain cases where it is cognizant, that is it is clearly visible that an individual is accused and he has committed a crime, then he has to be convicted quickly, not relying upon extensive details of the evidence, but trying to find the circumstantial ones as well. This is about today's current affairs. For any further updates, please subscribe to our channel, Kautilya Careers.